गुड आफ्टरनून चिल्ड्रन. लास्ट क्लास वी स्टार्टेड विद द डिसीज कैंसर एंड वी लर्न्ड अबाउट द टू क्लासिफिकेशंस ऑफ ट्यूमर्स. दे आर शरण टू टाइप्स ऑफ ट्यूमर्स
benign and malignant.
Which one is dangerous?
Malignant.
Why Malavika, malignant tumors are dangerous?
Because they multiply to different places.
Because?
They multiply to different places with surrounding cells.
One important point you are missing out. They don't remain. They are not confined to their place of origin. They will move and they get lodged at some other parts and start a new tumor over there, which spreads from one organ or one part of the body to the other. What do you call the tumor cells in malignant tumor? Donna? What type of cells? Tumor cells? Neoplastic tumor cells. So let's continue. So now we are going to learn about an important property of malignant tumors. Metastasis. So earlier you learned about another property, that is contact inhibition. Contact inhibition is a property of anybody?
Normal cells.
Now we are going to learn about the property of malignant tumors, that is metastasis. Cells from malignant tumors, they will escape from their place of origin and they will move to distant sites. So actually they will be, in the beginning they will be present at a particular place. From there they will move to distant sites, to other parts via bloodstream, and there they get lodged and they will start a new tumor. Maybe it has started in the, here in the picture you can see a primary cancer in the colon, and then from there in your intestine or in the intestine it has started, and from there moving to liver, then affecting lungs. So that is because of metastasis. So from one part it is getting spread to other parts, but this doesn't happen in the case of benign tumors. They'll be confined to one place, they don't spread to other parts. This one is dangerous because even after recovering from one tumor, or at the same time you can have tumors at different places. Cells from malignant tumors escape from their place of origin and they travel, they move distant sites, they move to different parts of the body through the blood, and where they get lodged, they will start another tumor. This property is known as metastasis. This property you call as metastasis. Once again, cells from malignant tumors escape from the place of their origin. They move to distant sites through the blood, and wherever they are getting lodged in the body, they will start a new tumor. Now, let's analyze some reasons, some causes for cancer, and any agents that can cause cancer, you call it as carcinogens. Carcinogens are agents that can cause cancer.
Ma'am?
Yes?
Can you show that previous slide once more?
Yes. Metastasis. Any explanation needed, Steffi, or just to copy the points?
Just to copy the points.
Yes. Michael has joined? No.
Yes, ma'am.
You are there?
Ma'am, you can change.
Yes. Causes. Oh my God. Just a minute. broadly categorize them into three agents: physical agents, chemical agents, and biological agents. Physical, chemical, and biological agents. Physical agents include ionizing radiations like X-rays, gamma rays, and non-ionizing radiations like UV, ultraviolet radiations, which can bring about damage to DNA. And once the DNA is damaged or DNA is mutated, it can lead to neoplastic tumor cells. Already you learned about neoplastic tumor cells. So it might transform into cancerous cells. So regular exposure or continuous exposure to ionizing radiations like X-rays, gamma rays, and non-ionizing radiations like UV rays can bring about damage to the DNA and can result in the formation of tumors. Moving on to the second category, chemical agents. Tobacco smoke is considered to be the most important cause of lung cancer. Vinyl chloride, PVC, plastic, vinyl chloride, asbestos. Just a minute, children. Agents include tobacco smoke, vinyl chloride, asbestos, nickel, etc. So these are some of the chemicals that can lead to cancer. Regular exposure or regularly smoking tobacco, regular exposure to vinyl chloride, asbestos, nickel, etc. can result in cancer, tumor formation. And the third agent, biological. Cancer-causing viruses, you call them as oncogenic viruses. And you call their genes as viral oncogenes. Cellular oncogenes or proto-oncogenes. Oncology, hope you might have heard about. Oncology. Yes or no? The branch which deals with cancer or tumor. And cellular oncogens or proto-oncogenes. Oncogenes or proto-oncogenes present in normal cells, when activated, can transform into oncogenic cells. I'll come to all the points once again. First one, physical agents, regular exposure to any of the radiations like ultraviolet radiations, gamma radiations, X-rays, etc. might cause damage to the DNA and can result in tumor formation. And so many chemical agents, tobacco smoke or smoke emitted from burning plastic, not just one day or 2 days, okay, regular exposure, or working in a factory that produces asbestos, or regular exposure to some nickel components, all that can result into regular exposure, continuous exposure, not a single exposure, single time exposure, that might lead to cancer. Then biological agents, there are certain viruses which can result in, which can promote or which can result in the formation of tumors. You call them as oncogenic viruses. And these viruses, oncogenic viruses, they are provided, they have a genes which you name as viral oncogenes. And cellular oncogenes or proto-oncogenes. So when you say cellular oncogenes or proto-oncogenes, they are not active. They will not form cancer or tumor at that stage. But if it is there in their body, we say, you know, in some cancer, in the case of certain cancers, heredity can be a reason in the family history. If repeatedly a particular type of cancer is found, there are chances, we say. So if these genes are there in their body, then they, for example, lung cancer. Okay, so if the genes responsible for the formation of cancer is there, such a person has to avoid smoking. But if these genes are there in his body, and if he is a chain smoker, then the chances are more than that of a normal person without these oncogenes. So they can get stimulated. They can turn into, they become active, and they can result in the formation of tumor when activated, or when it comes in contact with some cancer-causing agents. So biological agents, the two categories we discussed, surface. So cancer causing viruses are they? We call as oncogenic viruses, and these viruses which causes cancer are having special genes in their structure which you call as oncogenes. And cellular oncogenes or proto-oncogenes may be present in the normal cells, which when activated, upon activation, they can change into, they can get transformed into cancerous cells. So the three categories: physical agents, chemical agents, and biological. Now, how to detect? How can we detect and diagnose the disease? First method, biopsy. Biopsy, I think that is a term which you are very familiar with. We have often heard about this when something when the doctor is suspicious about a particular growth in our body, he might suggest for conducting biopsy test. So a sample of the tissue will be taken and biopsy test will be done. Histopathological studies, study of cells, and to see whether any infection is there or pathology is a branch which deals with all the disease-causing organisms, and histopathological studies, it deals with the histology, the study of cells. So that also biopsy and histo. Okay, children, so biopsy, hope you have understood. And histopathology, as I told you, pathology is the study of diseases, and histopathology means studying the cells and tissues to find out or diagnose diseases. Okay, histology, it is a branch which deals with the study of cells and tissues. Then second method, radiography using X-rays and CT scan, MRI scan. You are familiar with all these terms. CT scan is computed tomography scan, and MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. So that will give a better idea about the tumor formed in our body and how far the growth has proceeded, which all parts are affected. All that we'll come to know with the help of these scans. Then using antibodies against cancer-specific antigens. So that is another method with the help of, you know that antibodies are specific to each antigen. So by using antibodies against cancer-specific agents also, doctors can identify any cancerous growth in our body. Then the next is molecular biology techniques that will help in detecting cancer-related genes in individuals with inherited susceptibility to certain cancers. I told you, like certain cancers that can be hereditary also, that can be passed from the parents to children. So in such cases, it's not for sure, okay? It doesn't mean that if parents have a cancer, it will be passed on to children. There are possibilities, and this is also not applicable to all types of cancer. Certain cases in the family history, you can find many members getting. So there, that means there is a susceptibility. So in such case, they have to take extra precautions, and they have to go for periodic checkups and all. So molecular biology techniques will help to relate when it is related or when it is hereditary. So these oncogenes will be present in their body. So with the help of molecular biology techniques, these genes, oncogenes, or the cancer related genes can be detected. Those who are having inherited susceptibility to certain types of cancer. Once again, the different steps or different methods of detecting and diagnosing cancerous cells, biopsy and histopathological studies, radiography where X-rays are being used, and computer, two types of scan, computed CT scan, MRI scan, computed tomography scan, and also MRI or magnetic resonance imaging. And the next method is by using antibodies. As you know, antibodies are specific against each antigen. So with the help of these antibodies also, you can find out whether there is any cancerous growth in the body. And the last one is molecular biology techniques. This is highly useful in the case of individuals who have inherited susceptibility to certain cancers. So that will help you detect earlier any cancer related genes are present in the body or not. Okay. So I hope no doubt. So biopsy and histopathology, once again, I'm repeating, biopsy, as I said you already. So if some growth is found suspicious, then that from that particular part, tissue or cells will be removed and it will be, studies will be conducted. Histopathological studies will be conducted, the study, analyzing the cells and tissues to check for any disease. Need repetition? You show me the now. Okay. Next is about treatment. Huh? Once again, biopsy and histopathology. Yes, Nandana? Molecular biology. Okay. See, molecular biology techniques, the latest techniques where we can detect the genes with the help of molecular. You will be learning in detail about the recombinant DNA technology, molecular biology, different type of molecular biology techniques you will be dealing in chapter 6. So with the help of these molecular biology techniques, we will be able to detect the presence of certain genes. Okay. These genes, oncogenes, when these are present, earlier I told you that these genes, cellular oncogenes or proto-oncogenes, might be present in normal cells, and when these come in contact or when situations are favorable, they might turn into cancerous. Proto-oncogenes are not in the active stage, but this proto-oncogenes becomes the real active oncogenes when they get all the favorable conditions. So if there is a susceptibility, if a particular person suspects that he might get affected because in the family history, such a disease is there, he can go for this biology, molecular biology techniques, which will help in detecting the cancer related genes. So that if it is detected earlier, it will be highly helpful. So that he can prevent the disease, or even if it is already active, if it is diagnosed earlier, cure will be much easier. Treatment will be much easier. Okay. Nandana. Okay, let me. Oh, yes. Yes, Sanya.
Ma'am, can you explain biopsy and histopathological
studies? See, biopsy and histopathological studies means, like, if You don't know that there can be different growths in your body. All may not be cancer. All are not cancer. Maybe you have a swelling or a mass of cells growing. You know, you found a lump or a swelling in a particular part. But doctors need to find out whether this particular growth is cancerous or not. So that can be done only by analyzing, studying these cells or tissues taken from that part. So the doctors might remove that particular growth from there, and a tissue sample or a cell sample will be taken from there, and that will be sent to the laboratory to carry out biopsy test, where the cells and tissues will be analyzed in studies to find out the presence of any disease or presence of cancer. Okay, and if nothing is there, then the biopsy report will be negative. So we'll go for, we'll check whether any malignancy is there, any chances for such, tumor growth is there, or is it dangerous. Most of the cases, it will be benign, just a growth, just a mass. Okay, so then it will be removed and you'll be perfectly okay. But sometimes doctors doubt whether this is malignant or not. So then they test, or they suggest for a biopsy test where the cells will be analyzed, tissues will be analyzed to know whether it is cancerous or not. Okay. Where are you, Sanya? Clear? So we learned about metastasis. No, we started with metastasis. Vidur, what is meant by metastasis?
The cells from malignated tumors escape from the place of their origin and move to the distant places through it.
And once it reaches some other part, what will happen?
It forms new tumor.
They'll start another tumor over there. That is the most dangerous, dreadful property of cancerous cells. Then, we learned about the different agents. Michael, what are the different agents that can cause cancer?
Physical agents, chemical agents, and biological agents.
Good. Give me three physical agents, Steffi, that can cause cancer.
UV rays, X-rays, gamma rays.
Okay. And then we learned about certain genes that can cause cancer. What do you call them, Naureen?
Viral oncogenes.
That is present in virus. And we learned that in normal cells, sometimes certain genes will be present, which will become
cellular oncogenes or proto-oncogenes.
Okay. Then we learned about the different methods of diagnosing it. Just what are the different methods? Just the captions. That's fine.
Radiography, CT scan, and MRI.
Radiography using X-rays, then CT scan, MRI scan. Another method, Anthony?
Using antibodies.
Yes?
Using antibodies.
Using?
Antibodies.
Using antibodies against? Against? Cancer. Antigens. Then Sharon, another
biopsy and histopathological studies.
Lydia, another point. Lydia, Inachi. Lydia, you were present for spirit? You may.
It's not stable.
Lydia, your voice is not clear. You may message me. Then, Gayatri?
Molecular biology
techniques. How is it useful?
Detecting the genes in the individual.
Okay. So we'll continue. We have 3 minutes only, no? So we'll continue next class. Any doubts, children? Any doubts? If no doubts, we'll wind up.
Antibodies are used for detection or diagnosis.
Yes?
Antibodies are used for detection or diagnosis.
Antibodies are used for the?
Detection or diagnosis.
Both are same, no? To find out. Detecting some, cancerous cells and diagnosing it is more or less the same. Okay, detection and diagnosis. Detecting it and means identifying it and diagnosing it as that so-and-so disease. Okay. Clear? Shall I wind up? Okay, no doubts. Thank you, children. Do revise.
Thank you.